I hear the sickness in thy strength. tiny ones. One, two, one.
Oh,
Let us bring the affirmation of the Sabbath taken from Exodus 20, verse 8 to 9. It's also in the back page of your bulletin.
That's also on the screen.
We begin.
Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it.
for image worship is number 330.
Okay, let me get this back. Come on, let's move it. congratulations and let everybody to sing.
And if your mom and dad put your dinner on the table, would you expect to? Thank you. Oh, what bright kids. So please and thank you are words you should always remember to say. Now, Jesus told a story about some people who forget to say the very important words of thank you. In Jesus' time, a disease which is called leprosy, which causes sores to break all over the skin, was very common. And when people had that disease, they say they were unclean. They couldn't even stay in their own homes. They had to leave and live all by themselves. And if they hear someone coming, they had to shout out the word unclean. What would they say?
Clean.
So that anyone who is close to them would run away, because this disease actually can pass from one person to another. But not as bad as they may look at the time that you can't stay close. Only if you're like very, very close would it pass from one person to another. But these people couldn't even stay in their own homes. And when they're out, they had to stay unclean. So everyone would run away from them. So one day, Jim, Jesus was going through a village. And anywhere Jesus is, a crowd would follow after him so they could listen to the words he would teach and also that they could be healed. So there were 10 lepers on it, 10 of them, and they were shouting out, what's the word they had to say when anyone come near them?
Unclean.
Unclean. So of course they heard sounds coming and they said,
unclean.
And then someone else said, Jesus heard the word, Jesus, Master, please have mercy upon us. Well, couldn't get close to them, so Jesus shouted back, go and show yourself to the priest. And how many men were there? So they started doing what?
What instructions did you do?
Show themselves to the priest.
So they started running right back to the priest. And they had leprosy, so they couldn't go near anybody, they were forbidden. So while they were running, they looked at their skin. Did you see your skin?
Any
sores? Any pain? No, they looked at their skin, and before that, they had pain, they had sores, they couldn't go near anyone. And they started looking at their skin, and they looked, it was nice and clean, and fair like Jesus. There was nothing on their skin, and they were nothing to
eat.
So this one man said, wow, good thing. And he decided he was going to turn right back. How many of them were there? And one man decided he was going to turn back. And what words was he going to use?
Friend.
He was going to use a word. We'll find out. And Luke chapter 17, verse 17. Okay? So I'm going to ask Gianna to read this. How many of Gianna can read this? Glory to God. So he came back. So that one man came back of fell down in front of Jesus and he said, thank you, Jesus, for cleansing me and for healing me. And the other nine, I wouldn't say they weren't grateful, but they did not come back. They forgot to come back, or something happened and they did not come back. But Jesus made a note of it. Jesus asked, where are the other nine people who are healed? Didn't they see it important to come back and say, thank you, Jesus, for cleansing me? So Jesus does many things for us day after day. He provides you parents that will take care of you. He provides you a home to live. He provides you with family. He provides you clothes in the winter. He protects you. He has done so many things for us. And we should not forget to say,
thank you.
Thank you. We would like to pray to say, thank you, Jesus, for taking care of you and giving you all the things he's given you. Two people. Okay, Joshua.
Thank you, Daddy.
The sound
shines, giving long endless beam, and no clouds there will ever be seen. There'll be peace in the valley for me. Someday there'll be peace in the valley for me. I pray no more sorrow and sadness or trouble will be. There'll be peace, peace in the valley for me. There'll be peace in the valley for me. Someday there'll be peace in the valley for me. I pray no more sorrow or sadness or trouble will be. There'll be peace, peace in the valley for me.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Our scripture reading this morning is Matthew 25, 14 to 23. I will read alternately. May I found this please stand? Matthew 25, 14 to 23. And it says, "For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same, and made them another 5 talents.
And likewise he that had received 2 also gave another.
But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money.
After a long time, the Lord of the servants cometh and reckoneth with them.
And so, he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained besides them 5 talents more. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents besides them.
His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things, I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Amen.
It's time for prayer. We near as possible so we can pray.
Thank you.
Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Father, we thank you for this new opportunity to come to worship you in spirit and in truth. You have been with us every day of our life. You feed us, you shelter us. We have been under the shadow of the Almighty. For all your goodness, we give glory to you. We ask you for forgiveness. Forgive our sins, O Lord. Wash us in the blood of Jesus Christ, so we can be right as sin. Lord, I present to you my people around the world, especially those who are here, who they are nowadays. May you grant us thy peace and the desire of our heart. You know our problems, our weakness, our sickness, O Lord. I pray for the sick, the stained and the broken, the shut-ins, those who have prayer requests. I pray for the young people, for the children among us, for the visitors, those who visit us. Be with each one of us today, Lord. I pray for Brother Harris that we choose to deliver the message of the hour. May you and honor him with the Holy Spirit so the message can find a resting place now. Thank you, dear Lord, for answering our prayers today. And finally, in Jesus' name, may the Lord our life and the meditation of our heart be acceptable to thy son, O Lord, I stand in my redeemer. Amen.
And Father, Father, help and strength be given to us so we can do our jobs. And Lord, pay we get, the Father, the return yours. And Father, I pray for those who don't have a job, let them be given on. And Lord, we will job given strength to continue to work. Father, bless those who give, bless those who don't have to give. And we will not be with them, bless them, we pray. Amen.
Speaker for today is Ellen Arts. He's no stranger to the platform. He's preached before many times, and today is no different. Before he comes to us, Sister Arts will bring this one out with another selection. Amen, church?
Those who have educated before, children, school, and everyone. And thank you for being here. Notice we didn't see any hands raised for the visitors, but if there are any who come in after the greeting for the visitors, we just want to welcome you at this time. Could you just please turn to the person next to you and say welcome to the house of the Lord. The caption. The caption. Faithful stewards, cross your T's and dot your I's. Metaphorically speaking, in this topic, there are three keys and two eyes on which this sermon is built. During the next 40 minutes, we shall be, as faithful stewards, highlight the importance of crossing these T's and dotting these I's. Let us bow our heads. Holy Father in heaven, thank you so very much for this wonderful privilege you have extended to us that we can come to your house of worship. Now as I open my mouth to deliver the message you have placed on my heart to your people, may you overshadow us with that of your presence of your Holy Spirit, and grant that the words that I shall speak will do good to the hearers, and each soul will be closer drawn to you and be blessed. I pray for Christ's name's sake. Amen. A steward, by definition, is a paid worker, a paid manager, worker of a large household. And number two, it's an administrator as of finances and properties. Number three, it's one responsible for food or drinks in a club or in a restaurant. And number four, it's like on a ship or an airplane. In general, it's a person who manages another person's financial affairs. Within my estimation, it is somewhat unreasonable or even out of space for us to discuss the workers and their offices before discussing the employer or the owner and his domain or dominion. The Bible tells us in Psalm 24, verses 1 and 2, that the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he had founded it upon the sea and established it upon the floods. Take note here. The word founded comes from the Latin word fundus, or bottom, to set forth are the support, are the base. Number two, it brings into being or to set up or to establish. In this context, it is not the past tense or participle of find. It is the foundation. It is that which the heart, the earth is established upon. Secondly, the Genesis account must not be overlooked. In Genesis 1 verse 1 it reads, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And verse 27 states that God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Man and female created he them. Furthermore, there should not be any doubt in one's mind that God is indeed the creator and the sole owner of everything. Everything, visible and invisible. Whether there be thrones or dominions or principalities or power. All things were made by him and for him, as according to Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16. Therefore, mankind is nothing more than a creative being, or created beings, or stewards and stewardess, holding the office of stewardship, and is accountable or answerable to God. Amen? Amen. Crossing the first key. As educated and intelligent as you all are, you will agree with me that one cannot correctly write the phrase faithful stewards or faithful stewardship without crossing the T's and dotting the I's. Even so, in like manner, we as professed Seventh-day Adventist Christians cannot claim to be stewards and stewardess and not be found faithful. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul declares, let a man so account of us. And there's no doubt he also meant, let a woman also account of us as of the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. God is not doing business with us. Neither are we doing business with him. But as faithful stewards and stewardess, it is important, very important, that we have a business-like approach. Amen? Yeah. That is, to be efficient, to be practical, to be orderly and systematic in all respects. Amen? In the faithful stewards, our stewardship, the first key that we need to cross, as it were, is that of time. The Webster's Dictionary equates this as every moment there is or ever have been, or ever will be. By virtue of the Holy Spirit, based on the written word of God, we understand that this world in which we live is not the first or the only world that God has created. According to the scripture, the spirit of prophecy, rather, we have the unfallen world. However, time in our world is not the only issue. God created the first day, and the work he did on that day, as found in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 5. As you know, there are a host of useful adjectives that describes time. For instance, we have acceptable time, we have bad time, and beginning of time, we have the end of time. We have hard times, we have mean times, we have perilous times, troublesome times, say, borrowed times, and prophetic times, and that's just to name a few. However, the time which we will now be focusing on is holy time, or sacred times. As stated in Genesis chapter 2, 1 through 3, thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the hosts of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it. That is, the word sanctified means that it has been set aside for holy purposes. Because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. Now there should not be any doubt in our minds that sin has caused a breach in God's perfect creation, which by virtue of his divine justice and love, he laid down his life in order to redeem lost mankind. What do you say? Thank you, O God. Thank you for Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. And though God promised to recreate all things according to the prophet Isaiah, Isaiah 65 verse 17, it reads thus. Behold, I create new heavens and new earth. And the former shall not be remembered nor come to mind. I am here to tell you that although God will indeed create or make all things new as he had promised, yet the sacred times between sunset on the sixth day to sunset on the seventh day of our current week will remain the same. Amen. It will remain the same as is and will continue throughout eternity. As recorded in Isaiah 66, 22, 23, it states thus. For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I shall make, shall remain before me, said the Lord of hosts, so shall your seed and your name remain. Amen. And it shall come to pass that from one new moon to another, and from one Sabbath to another, shall all flesh come to worship before me, says the Lord.
Amen.
How diligent are we today as stewards of time? How diligent. Jesus heals the sick on the Sabbath day, or the impotent man at the pool of Bethesda on the seventh day, the Sabbath day. And they, the scribes, the Jews, the Pharisees, they ridiculed him. According to him, of violating the Sabbath by doing the work of healing on the Sabbath day. His response was, my Father worketh, and I work also. Please do not get this statement out of context, as they did it back then.
There is a certain word that are
allowed between secular work and sacred work. So then, the work that Jesus Christ did is of course termed as sacred work. We are supposed to do good to all, regardless of what day or time it may be. Jesus said that the Lord, the Father, sent rain, not only on the just, but also on the unjust. And we notice rain falls even on the Sabbath day. The big question, how about our denomination, the Seventh-day Adventist Church worldwide, that not only has schools and universities that are closed on the Sabbath day, but they also have clinics, hospitals, etc., that are open to the public on the Sabbath day? There is no doubt in my mind that these acts are acceptable to God. Amen?
Amen?
Furthermore, in the medical field, there are doctors and surgeons who work on the Sabbath day. Yes, nurses, etc. They are Seventh-day Adventists. And unlike Jesus, they are being paid for are stipend for the work done on the Sabbath day. In this respect, how can such persons cross their T's for time? In other words, how do they work this out with their God? Let me give you a few hints. There are several legal ways for working this out with our God. At the same time, there are many who does not take this as an issue, while there are others who wrestle day and night to find a solution. Here are a few tips. Number one, do not tell your employer not to pay you for those times, for the sacred hours you work on the Sabbath in the medical field. Amen? Number two, some people give that money to charity. Some add that amount to their budget offering. And some give it as investment offering to the church. And by the way,
we heard the emphasis on investment.
That we are currently in the investment week, or month, closing up for the year. Now, while there are others who prefer to retain or return 90% of that sum of money that they work during those sacred hours, 90% of it they give as tithes and offering instead of the normal 10% plus offering, while they withhold only 10% for their time
or the portion amount earned on the sacred time are just enough to cover their expenses. Remember, whatever we do,
we will have to give an account of
ourselves to God. Amen? So be careful, be tactful, and be sober in whatever we do. Ladies and gentlemen,
this brings us to the last two keys that they are.
The last two keys. And they are for talent and for treasure. The word talent, as defined by the dictionary, is an ancient unit of weight or money, and B, any natural ability or power. C, a superior ability in the art or craft. And the word treasure is defined as A, accumulated wealth or as money, jewelry, etc. And B, any person or thing considered valuable. There are, as you see, these two words are correlated. Therefore, I think it not robbery to discuss them jointly, as Jesus also did in Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 to 13. And you may turn your Bible there with me. Now look how these two words cross their teeth. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. In verse 15, unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. To everyone, make special note, to everyone according to his ability. And straightway he took his journey. And
verse 16, then by that, then he that had received the 5 talents, he went and traded with it and made another 5 talents on it. In like manner, he who received 2 gained 2 more. Amen. Now, how well do you think these faithful stewards cross their T's and dot their I's? They did well, ain't it? But here, in verse 18, it flips the coin. It reads, let us look at verse 18. But he that had received the 1, he went and did in the earth and hid his Lord's money. And hid the Lord's money. In other words, he refused to do the work that the Lord had asked him to do. He refused to invest. How miserable this slothful steward must have been. He failed to cross his T's and to dot his I's. For us stewards and stewardess living in a time as this, when the Lord is soon to come, if we fail to cross our T's and dot our I's now, then we will no doubt be as that wicked and slothful steward as here mentioned. To my fellow stewards and stewardess under the hearing of my voice, and who for some reason you may be afraid and have hidden the talent which the Lord has blessed you with, or has proven unfaithful otherwise, there may just be little time left, just a little time left, to respond to the appeal. For the Lord, as recorded in Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10, he says, bring ye all your tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, and prove me now herewith, saith the Lord, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that you may not have room enough to receive it. The adjective all here means everything. This brings every bond, it breaks every bond, and it leaps over every boundary. That is, nothing should be left out, whether it be the product of the land or the flocks of the field, nothing should be left out. It may be of the gifts you have received, or of the treasures that you have found, whether it be of the pocket money that you receive, or your wages that you have earned, everything. Nothing that comes into you, you should not have given the Lord his portion. Now, I have a little story to share with you. While I was living in the island of Jamaica, and I was living in Kingston and my parents in the country area of St. Elizabeth, I remember once, after going down to spend the holidays, my father, my mother, says to me, "No, Rod,
must I return
tithes of the money that you sent me, seeing you have already paid your tithe or returned your tithe from me, and then that give me, should we return tithe in our church for, you know, suddenly?" So I couldn't have answered right away out my tongue. So I stopped and I think it over a little, and I said, "Yes, Mom, I think you all should pay your tithes, return your tithes of it." No, the point that I have gathered, or the point I reached,
why I agree that they should
pay, is the fact that I am not living there. If I was living there and I gave some money for to run the house or to help in running the house, then they would not need to pay tithes from that. But whatever I give to them, it's for them.
They don't
even have to spend it. They don't, whatever they want to do with it, they may do so. Therefore, it is within their responsibility to return the tithes of that bill that I gave to them. What do you think? Most of us are not to be in agreement with that. But whatever money comes your way, whatever you get, whether you find it or you earn it, or the family member giving it to you, you should return to the Lord his portion.
That's right.
As it says, turn with me now in your Bibles and read in Matthew chapter 25. Verses 19 to 30. "And after a long time, the Lord of these servants cometh and reckoned with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought unto other 5 talents, saying, 'Lord, thou delivered unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more.' And the Lord said unto them, 'Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.' He also that had received 2 talents came and said, 'Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 others beside them.' His Lord said unto him, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. Yea, thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee a ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord.' Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, 'Lord, I know thee that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sowed, and gathering where thou hast not destroyed.' Yea, and he said unto him, and he said, 'Where am I?'" 25. "And I was afraid, and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, here thou hast that is thine.' His Lord answered and said unto him, 'Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knowest that I reap where I sow not, and gather where I have not sown. Thou ought therefore to have put my money to the exchangers. Then at my coming I shall have received mine own with usury." Oh man, Take therefore the talents from him, and give it unto him that hath 10 talents. For unto everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath. And verse 30, and cast he the unprofitable servant into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Now, you will agree with me that the contrast between the faithful and the unfaithful stewards are visibly clear. Amen? We notice the difference between the faithful and the unfaithful are very, very clear. All stand point. What about the things that they are in common? We notice the things that they have, the difference between them was so plain. One was willing to work and to do this work, to put his money into use and get an interest or to get profit on it, and the other don't. Now, what were the common things or common issues with these two set of people? Now, it is very important that we identify at least three of them. They all had the same opportunity and privilege. Amen? And so it is with us as stewards and stewardess today. We all have the same opportunity and privilege. Number two, they were asked to work accordingly. That is, to their own ability. That means the man who have not a skill, we're not asking him to do money. The Lord said that even if you take the money and put it in the bank, that it earns an interest. You don't have to go and do any work, right? Do something. Now, it is stated that if a man will not work, we should neither let him eat. As in 2 Thessalonians 3 and verse 10. There are a lot of people who term this as saying that we should not, it is sin to feed a lazy person. But though that phrase is not in the scripture, this is where they got it from. If a man will not work, neither let him eat. Right? So then, for example, as to where tithes and offerings are concerned, 10% of our possession is holy unto the Lord. 10% is holy unto the Lord. Irrespective of how much or how little you earn or get, 10% is of the Lord. Number three, they all, and I repeat, they all regard their master as a hard man. You may not have looked at it that way, but let me get into this. They all regard their master as a hard man, reaping where he sowed not, and gather where he has not sown. That is, where he has not scattered anything, he go and gather it up, and he must throw out any seed, but he don't scatter it up, according to verse 26. The fact that these two servants went and worked the money, it simply means that they were saying, I can't afford for my master to come back and not see any reward and not get any interest on his money that he gave to me, because he is a hard man and I don't want to be thrown out of the kingdom. I don't want to be thrown out, and I know if he come and don't get any result, hey, I'm going to be out of commission. Yeah. So they
Therefore, all of them consider the master as a hard man. It's not only just the one guy, but he was so mean that he don't even want to work. Eh? He should not even eat, as what the Bible says. If a man will not work, don't let him eat either. So, the fact that he could be, that they were willing to work, they got the well done from the master when he returned. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been dutiful over a few things. Now I make you ruler over many things. Now here is something I need to get across to parents as pertaining to training up a child. With this in mind, parents need to train their kids or their young people to become faithful stewards by giving them pocket monies or pay them to run a certain errand. Then see to it that they return a faithful tithe from all that people that you gave them. Yes, that's in training them. According to Proverbs 22 and verse 6, it says, train up a child in the way he should go, that when he's old, he will not depart from it. Now, finally, duck your eyes. There are two eyes in faithful stewards and stewardship. The first eye, integrity, and the next one, intend. For the interest of time, we will view them together. Integrity, according to the dictionary, is completeness. One, completeness. Two, wholeness. Unimpaired condition. Number three, soundness, honesty, and sincerity, etc. The verb intend, from which comes the adjective intent or intention, means to plan, purpose, to mean something to be or used for. The Bible states that without faith, it is impossible to please him. I am of the opinion that we all know the story of faithful Job. And this is, of course, the lesson we are, the quarter in which we are studying our quarterly about Job, the adult Sabbath school lesson. However, let's turn to Job chapter 2 and verse 3. It reads thus. And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in all the earth, a perfect and upright man, one that feareth God and escheweth evil, and still he holdeth fast his integrity, although thou hungerest me against him, to destroy him without a cause. Perfect. Let us look at integrity. The non-integrity equates completeness or wholeness. That is, not half and half. Amen? Yeah. It's no half and half. No pimsy, no clumsy. Yeah. No hanky, no panky. Yeah. Yeah. They are but honesty and soundness. In other words, death before dishonor. Yes, death before dishonor. Here is a crucial question asked by God in Malachi 3 and verse 8. Will a man rob God? Would any of God's stewards rob him? Would any of his stewardess rob him? It is hard to believe that any would dare to do so. People says all manner of evil against us as Seventh-day Adventists. Just as they did against Job. Some say that the Seventh-day Adventist people or church is nothing but a cult following a man named Jesus and a woman called Ellen G. White, both of which died many years ago. Some say that we, the Seventh-day Adventists, are keeping the law in order to be saved. Some says that since this kind of glory has been taken up and the veil of the temple has been rendered asunder, and the priests and the tribes of Levi no longer functioning, therefore there is no need for tithes and offering, because the church age is over. But I would like to tell them that we are no cult. Amen. We do not follow cunning devised tables as they suppose. Secondly, we keep God's holy law in order, in obedience to his word, by exercising faith in Christ Jesus, our Savior, who has saved us by grace as a result of his spilled blood on Calvary's cross. And finally, we return a faithful tithe and offering because God has requested it at our hands. Amen? Amen. To finish the work of spreading the gospel of the kingdom towards the world. And that we strive for moral soundness when we are honest to our God and give willingly to his cause. Amen. We are at the same time as with Job, demonstrating our integrity, or the moral soundness of our intention. Job declared, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. But I will maintain my integrity, are my own ways before him. Yes. We are faithful to the Lord and we will remain that way. Therefore, we intend by the grace of God to hold our integrity though the heavens fall. Yes. And though the mountains be carried out away into the sea. I will not short change, my God, or I will not hold back on any portion of my possession or income that the Lord claimed to be holy unto him. So that when he comes, we may hear from our blessed Savior says, well done and welcome, well done, welcome into the joy of thy Lord. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. Now I make you ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of our Lord. How many of us are longing to hear these words? Now, if we be faithful, sure enough, we will hear these words from our blessed Savior's lips. And may the Lord help us, that as we prepare to meet him and prepare to return to glory with him, that we shall be able to be with Job and all the faithful ones who are now sleeping in the grave. We will be with them together to give all honor and glory and praise and dominion to our God, who lives and reigns throughout eternity. Thank you. Have a happy Sabbath.
Amen. Amen, church.
Amen.
This time for the Irish form of the sermon. We bring the service to a close with a single hymn 602 from our church in 602.
Shall tell for the faithfulness now, when bright smiles of gladness shall scatter the cares. A coronet gleam on thy brow. O brother, O sister, be faithful. The promise is sure that waits for the faithful and tried to reign with a ransom, immortal and pure, and ever with Jesus abide. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Holy Father in heaven, we thank you, O God, for these words of encouragement and promises that you have made. As we look around us, we study our scriptures, the word, we have seen, O God, that your coming is at the door, nearer than we think. And so, Lord, help us to make our calling and our election sure. Help us to help others to make their calling sure as well. And these words that thou hast given unto us, Lord, help that we may put them in action and prepare ourselves to meet you in peace, so that when our Lord Jesus shall return, we all may hear, "Well done, enter thou into the joy of our Lord." These blessings we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior.
Thank you.